This is GM Word of the Week, and I'm Fiddleback. Crepuscular.
Heavenly shades of night are falling. It's the twilight time. Out of the mist,
the sun finally dips below the horizon, and the hills are bathed in a red gold light as twilight descends upon you. The elf warns, it is time to make camp. The hunters of the wild will be out in force now. The twilight is their time.
Fingers of night will soon surrender.
Remember back when the Monster Manual, or the Monstrous Compendium if you're of a specific generation of D&D gamer, listed activity cycles for all the little beasties? Let's talk about activity cycles. Specifically, let's talk about all the animals that are not nocturnal. See, a lot of the normal animals we think of as nocturnal aren't really nocturnal. Lots of rodents and mini bats, also cats, some wild canines, moths, and lots of other insects. It's actually a pretty long list. You thought your cat was nocturnal, right? But mini cats are actually crepuscular. Crepuscular animals are neither nocturnal, which means their activity peaks at night, nor diurnal, with activity that peaks during the day. Their activity peaks at dawn and at dusk. They are most active in the twilight hours. In fact, crepuscular comes from the Latin word for twilight. And twilight can be the most dangerous time to be out and about in the wilderness because so many predators are crepuscular. So how can you use this in your game? Oh, sorry. You thought that was kind of short? Fine. Let's talk about New Zealand and about demigod sibling rivalry and the imprisonment of the sun. Do you know what else is crepuscular apart from various animals? Rays of sunlight. Specifically, crepuscular rays. Crepuscular rays are those shafts of slanting light that come down between the clouds or between objects. Ancient temples and movies always have them because they look so damned cool. Well, those are crepuscular rays. But they have a lot of other nicknames, too. The ancient Greeks called them water draws because they had this crazy theory that water rubbed sunbeams into the sky to turn into rain. Oh, those wacky Greeks. They're also called Jacob's Ladder, after a biblical tale in which Jacob dreamed of a staircase to heaven. And they are also called Taura Amaui, which is Maori for ropes of Maui. Maui, in this case, is not the Hawaiian island. Rather, it refers to a Polynesian demigod, which is why the phrase is of Maori origin. If you didn't know, the Maori were the original settlers of the islands of New Zealand. They arrived sometime in the 13th century, which makes New Zealand one of the last landmasses ever to be settled by human beings. And New Zealand has a pretty interesting relationship with the demigod Maui. Maui, whose full name is Maui Tiki Tiki Ataranga, which translates roughly to Maui, the hair of his mother Taranga, for reasons that would take a little too long to explain, did not get along with his brothers, which would also take a little too long to explain. What's important is that his brothers were going fishing one day, and they left him behind. So, he took his own canoe and an ancient enchanted jawbone, which he made into a fishing hook and went fishing on his own. He fished up a giant fish, and his brothers saw it and rowed over. They wanted to cut up the fish at once, but Maui insisted on making a proper offering to the god Tangaroa, who ruled the sea, first. His brothers wouldn't listen and started cutting up the giant fish. According to Maori legend, the giant fish was the northern island of New Zealand, and all the valleys and rivers are the cuts his brothers made. The southern island is Maui's canoe. So why are shafts of sunlight, crepuscular rays, called ropes of Maui? Well, before Maui used the jawbone, which belonged to one of his ancestors, to fish up New Zealand, he used it to beat the sun into submission. See? Again, according to Maori legends, the sun was whipping through the sky so fast in ancient times that there weren't enough hours in the day to get anything done. We've all felt that way, of course. But Maui went out and did something about it. On a hunt, he, with the help of his jealous brothers, lassoed the sun and beat it with a jawbone until it agreed to slow the hell down and let them have a nice, long day. Thus, in addition to pulling islands out of the sea, Maui is also the reason why you have to work at least 8 hours every day. Thanks, Maui. So crepuscular rays, shafts of sunlight, are called the ropes of Maui because they resemble the ropes he used to lasso the sun. But there is something else crepuscular on New Zealand, and we'll end our story with it. Cats. See, New Zealand didn't have any terrestrial mammals. So when the Maori arrived, insects, birds, and reptiles had evolved to fill every ecological niche on the islands. But the settling Maori, and later Europeans, and then everyone else, brought various animals with them. Among them, cats. Cat ownership is extremely popular now in New Zealand. But it's also problematic. They have become what is called an invasive species. That's when a new animal arrives in a place and outcompetes all of the other animals in that place because there are no predators or other natural checks on the new animal population. And stray and feral cats are just that. And while they control other invasive species like rats, they are also driving native reptiles and birds to extinction. The ecology of a given place is usually reliant on a very delicate balance. And the sudden introduction of a new species can be an ecological disaster. There are two great takeaways for your game here. The first is the story of Maui. Or rather, why are there so few stories like the story of Maui in D&D lore? In a universe where the pantheon of gods is objectively real and provable, why don't more stories like that figure into the creation myth of the campaign world? Most DMs and campaign authors design worlds that are explainable with natural processes, plate tectonics, and geology, and meteorology, and stuff like that. And there's no reason for that. You have a perfect excuse for things being wonderful and inexplicable. Use it. The other great story is the story of invasive species. Granted, that isn't great from an ecological standpoint, but think about all of the problems that could be caused when settlers or refugees bring their pets to an environment that can't handle them, or where they are brought in on purpose. What if a city introduces slimes and oozes to control the dire rat problems in the sewers? What if they discover that the slimes and oozes are now the dominant species and are taking over? That's great fodder for an adventure. This has been the GM Word of the Week. It's written by the Angry GM and produced and recorded by me, Fiddleback. You can find more at madadventures.com and theangrygm.com.